And whenever people spoke about progress before then, it was the individual making progress in something, usually moral and spiritual. But you could also say, I'm making progress in learning French, which we still use in the English language. But the idea of progress as an abstract idea which drives history and drives civilization was really the secularization of the Christian idea of the divine incarnation in Christ, in a certain sense. That this is a very complicated theological question. We'll come back to it later on in the course. In Christianity, in contrast to, let's say, Hinduism or Buddhism or Islam, which is a monotheistic religion like Christianity, and also somewhat in contrast to Judaism, although Judaism considered history to be very important, did not accept the idea of incarnation. But since you had the incarnation of God in history, that is, truth or reality had entered into history, the process of history had to have an ultimate divine significance. In a sense, God is himself being transformed by history. History gained a new meaning, a new sense. And as Western society became secularized, when secularization takes place, the vessels are never broken. What happens is that their content changes. This one sentence I mentioned to you, if you really think about it, was the key to the understanding of everything that goes on in our world, both within individuals and in society at large. What do I mean by that? I mean, let's say the categories by which a particular civilization or human beings think, that does not change so much with secularization. What changes is what's inside those categories. That's why, for example, when Japan becomes modernistic, the Japanese do not begin to think as a secularized Christian, Muslim, or Jew would think. They begin to think as a secularized Buddhist would think. And therefore, it's another form of secularism. Now, what happened in the West, because the main religion of the West was Christianity, it had emphasized the incarnation, and therefore the entry of truth into history, the secularization of history, implied actually the idea of the rise of progress as being connected to the flow of time itself. That in the 19th century, people began to have this unbelievable idea, which for us seems so absurd because of two world wars, it's only the politicians that believe in it, that by virtue of time passing by, things get better and better. And this is still is lingering on at the end of the 20th century when people say, my God, we're in 1995 and people are still killing each other. Or using the word medieval in a pejorative sense, which is the background idea that, we are in the 20th century, 20th century is better than the 19th century, 19th is better than 18th, and therefore the bad things which are associated with the old days should not be in our own times. This great idol is really the main idol of Western thought. This is the God that Western thought worshipped in the 19th century more than anything else. The God of progress, in this sense, drove the engine of Western civilization. All of those civilizations around the world which were decimated by the colonial powers of Europe in the 18th and 19th century, the moral background of it, nobody came and said we're destroying India in order to get rich. I mean, the British never said that. It was the white man's burden to bring progress when all of these natives were being massacred in Central America, in North America. What made people's conscience laid and peaceful was that they were bringing about progress. And the idea then that which was added to that, which came from Darwinian evolution, the survival of the fittest, was added to that. That was not necessarily the same idea. Evolution, Darwinism, and progress are not the same ideas. But they all became molded together in the 19th century through very complicated sets of intellectual and philosophical processes, which we do not have to be concerned with now. We'll come back to it again later in the course. But the net result was that Western civilization saw its very workings out as being indicative of the progress of the human state, of mankind. Yes? In a very different light, very, very different light. For example, when the Spaniards captured Peru and assassinated the Inca king and took over all the gold, they said that we're bringing to them Christianity, we're bringing to them salvation to the Indians, but nobody spoke about progress at that time. The idea of progress gradually began to creep in the 18th century. The religious idea of bringing a new message, bringing Christianity, bringing civilization was there. That was there. But the idea of progress in the philosophical sense didn't really take off in the West until the 18th century, but especially in the 19th century, that it became the central idea, what motivated and drove people in Western civilization. And still it's not dead by any means. It began to receive its first death knell with the First World War. With the First World War, although the most civilized nations in the world, that is France, England, and Germany, were killing each other off, they killed a million of each, just facing each other with chemical gas and so forth. Nevertheless, they thought this was the war to end all wars. European civilization went on gleefully afterwards, again preaching the gospel of progress throughout the world. The difference was that now, the Western poets and writers and thinkers began to think there's something wrong. There's nothing more significant than between the First War and the Second World War, the leading poet of the English language, T.S. Eliot, wrote The Wasteland, or the four quartets of T.S. Eliot, the last works, or The Life After Jeff Prufrock, or other poets, or other great poets in France, the same way. That is, the criticism began first among artists and poets and writers. But after the Second World War, you don't have to be very intelligent to think that this is not, we're not progressing very far, after having killed another 30 million people, and especially the most civilized country in the middle of Europe, that is Germany, carrying out these unbelievable massacres and which were horrendous and unforeseen and never seen in human history on that dimension. So it really got its jolting after the Second World War. Anyway, as far as this course is concerned, what is significant was that all of the political philosophies that came out of Europe in the 19th century all agreed on one thing, and that was the idea of progress. And progress was always connected to material progress. And the other forms of progress were tied to it because people did not want to accept they were completely materialistic. And what made it possible was modern science, because you had modern science, which was advancing all the time, so people believed there was progress in modern science, and then gradually technology, which went along with it. And people thought it was also moral progress, artistic progress, other kinds of progress, which we don't talk about anymore, since we now kill a lot more of our children in the streets now than we did in Washington in 1890. People don't dare talk about moral progress anymore. But they did until a few decades ago. People thought that material progress brought with it all of the other forms of progress. Now, as far as the environment was concerned, as I told you last time, the other continents of the world were not participating in this process. This is extremely important to understand for what's going on in the world today. That is, Japan was still before the Meiji Restoration, and when the Meiji Restoration came, it was only in the late 19th century that Japan began to industrialize. India was still a completely rural country. China is only now, in our generation, beginning to industrialize. And the Islamic world also kept aloof more consciously than perhaps other parts of the world from this process. And therefore, the water, the air, the resources of the earth seem to be infinite. That is, the idea that the future of humanity is to use more and more, have more material things, and so forth, did not seem to be contradicted by the state of the earth. You do not have a single major thinker of the 19th century, including scientists, major scientists, who would say, look, if all the rivers of the world become like the Hudson River and all the valleys like the Ruhr Valley, we're all going to suffocate to death. The rest of the world was like a fresh green field from which you got raw materials and you used it in your factories and you became rich. And also brought military power with which you could dominate the rest of the world. So nobody thought about that. And the Western machine, you might say, of transformation, which was connected with modern technology and science, believed that this was inevitable. And so the political philosophies that came out of 19th century Europe were all based on the idea of progress in a kind of abstract and absolute sense. And they bifurcated into two extreme forms. The left gradually grew from the 1840s and 50s. There is the modern idea of leftism. And everything to do with the Industrial Revolution, by the displaced workers. And the idea you had the workers' uprising in the middle of 19th century, the commune movement, the communist manifesto, then the appearance, of course, of Karl Marx, and before that, Feuerbach, and who set the philosophical tone for materialism, dialectical materialism. All of this represented the left, which saw, in fact, the problem in the lack of correct distribution of wealth. It did not see the problem in the way in which the resources of the world of nature were used. And from the left, finally, came Marxism, There are other kinds of leftist movement, including socialism, which is still around. I mean, Mitterrand just died 2 weeks ago. He was socialist president of France. French socialism, Fabian socialism in England. America had some forms of socialism in the 19th century, not as powerful. But the most central and powerful force in the left, of course, was communism until 1989. And it hasn't died out. It's still living in China and having a rebirth in Russia. So it's not a dead force completely. But communism made material progress a part of its dogma. Because communism is a pseudo-religion. All ideologies in the 19th century are pseudo-religious, but especially communism has its own eschatology, pseudo-eschatology of the perfect society in the future, has it tried to draw its own ethics from the study of society, and has its own pseudo-rituals. Its saints were involved in Kremlin, like the old saints of the Greek Orthodox Church, whose bodies never decayed, with the sign of sainthood in the Orthodox Church, that the body of the saint would never decay. It's interesting that as soon as communism came to Russia, the pseudo-saints of the new religion, that is Lenin and so on, they were all involved lying down there to take the place of those old saints. So this pseudo-religion had as one of its props, one of its main dogmas, material progress. And therefore, the environment meant absolutely nothing to communism. And that is why the greatest devastation upon the world of nature in the 20th century were brought upon by the communist countries. And let me add here something which is very important to mention. In the 1950s and 60s and 70s, China was the great darling of the extreme left in Europe, and to some extent in the United States. China could do no wrong for the left. As gradually people began to discover that Stalin had killed about 30 million of his countrymen and women, some people got a cold feet as far as Russian communism was concerned. But everybody thought that China, nobody ever talked about all the heads coming down the Yangtze River during Mao Zedong. Nobody ever spoke about that. It was taboo also in America because much of the press was controlled by very powerful pens from the left at that time. There's no doubt about that. You never read about it. And everybody thought that China had a wonderful record for the environment. It was environmentally very, very sound, much more than the West. Of course it was because they didn't have the money. As soon as they got the money, look what's happening to Shanghai now. Shanghai is the second New York. And you're going to have catastrophes. I mean, really, environmental catastrophes in China in the next decade or two. Absolutely no doubt about it. So the left, as it manifested itself in the 20th century then, and the two powerful units, that is the former Soviet Union and China, two great countries that became communist, both of them considered the desecration of nature, what we call desecration, destruction of nature, to be an irrelevant category, because material progress was inevitable historically. It was part of historical determinism. The dialectic of Marxism posits that the very movement of history increases man's power over nature and the material possessions of man, and changes the relationship between man and nature from one of living together to one of complete dominance. And all Marxist philosophers, during the time of Lenin and Stalin and even Brezhnev, and up to Gorbachev, have written about this. It was a part and parcel of Soviet policy. So this was the left. The right, which was then the laissez-faire democratic right, I'm not here talking about the extreme right like Hitler and Mussolini and people like that in the 20th century. In the 19th century, that was not there. You had these monarchies, of course, you had a lot of power, but more or less their economy was a kind of laissez-faire, what we call now capitalistic economy. That also was based completely on the same thesis. And in fact, capitalism is bound to making money, to increasing capital. And therefore, its very philosophy cannot consider any factor which would be a limit to its creation of wealth. And at that time, people knew no other way of creating wealth except to create more and more new technology, to bring out mines, to build motors, energy, and all of the other products that were made with the machine. So the two political trends that came out of the 19th century both inherited the idea of progress. And when we come to the 20th century, it's very interesting. In all the ups and downs of political life during this century, both democracy and communism agreed completely on this point of a domination of man over nature, or human beings over nature, and the praise of modern technology. I will turn to that in just a moment. It's a very, very important issue. When the extreme rightist movements began in Europe as a result of what happened after the First World War, because the German power of the First World War was not an extreme rightist form of government. It was actually the old German Empire. The Kaiser. Kaiser simply means emperor in German. That was the old Germanic states which had come together and was no different from the English or any other monarchy in Europe. And it was no less nor more capitalistic than any of the other countries in Western Europe. They all shared in their economic form of life. But later on, when you had democratic socialism and nationalistic socialism, especially nationalistic socialism, which dominated over democratic socialism and became extremely rightist, that is the Fascist Party in Italy and later on the Nazi Party in Germany, who were the extreme right and who opposed, in fact, communism. And they thought that they were the real enemies of communism, not democracy. And they were trying to woo the democratic powers on their side against Russia, if you remember your history of the 1920s and 1930s. They also opted, of course, for the maximum amount of use of modern technology, maximum amount of use of the domination over nature, and they did not offer any alternative at all. In fact, it was even much worse than the other two countries because you had no say whatsoever. So you had three models then for a couple of decades. The extreme right in Europe, the democracies in Europe and America, not South America was democratic, but it was sort of like the extreme right as far as political life is concerned, but economically it was very similar to North America, except not as successful. And then you had the left, which was ruling over Russia, and it's what it captured in Central Asia, and then after the Second World War, it took over Eastern Europe until it collapsed in 1989. So you had a very interesting situation, which had everything to do with the dimensions of the crisis, the environmental crisis in the world today. That is, Western civilization, which because of its military power had become dominant in the 19th century over the whole of the globe, practically. A few spots it did not capture directly, like Japan, like my own country, Iran, like the Ottoman Empire, but the rest of the world it took over, more or less. Every form of political philosophy that it offered, and every form of political philosophy that was put into practice, that became forms of government, were based on the maximum impact of human beings upon the world of nature. There was no government that offered a policy of human beings living in conformity and in harmony with the natural environment. None of them. And the reason this is significant was that the people who were then being dominated by these forces emulated these forces in order to become independent. That's why the environmental crisis became global. That is, supposing you were an Indonesian and you wanted to get rid of the Dutch, what would you do? You could not shoot bows and arrows at Dutch gunships. You would have to try to develop your own artillery. Once you had to develop your own artillery, you had to have military technology. Once you had to have military technology, you had to have engineers who would then have to have other forms of technology. Military technology needed gas or oil. You needed to have energy and so forth and so on. And so the very process of overthrowing the colonial powers in the 19th century throughout the world brought with it philosophies which in fact shared the philosophy of those who dominated over them. In China, in Japan, in the Arab world, in Turkey, in Iran, in Indonesia, in Africa, where they were successful. Where they were not successful is because they could not, in fact, answer in kind. In order for Morocco to kick out the French, or the Algerians in the great civil war, war of independence against France, in which a million Algerians were killed, they had to have guns. They had to have organization. And so the people who came to the fore to bring about the independence of Algeria, they were not interested in traditional Islamic politics or philosophy. They were, in fact, like the people they were fighting against. And that is why, as these countries became independent, one by one, they began to be ruled by political, quote-unquote, elites who shared completely with the West views concerning the relationship to the environment, to nature, to technology, to economics. It had nothing to do with their own philosophies, with their own culture. There's only one great exception to this, and I want to talk about that. And that is Mahatma Gandhi and the independence of India. This we must understand because it's the only major voice in the 20th century who spoke against modern technology and the destruction of nature. Now, Gandhi has been discussed a great deal. You all know his name. He's a very famous figure. Whether he did this for expediency or he really believed in it, I will not get into it. I do not think that Gandhi was the greatest saint that India produced, nor do I think he was just actually a clever politician. He was a very great man, Mahatma Gandhi. There's no doubt about that. And he gave of himself. And he started a method of sort of reprisal against the British Empire, which was a method of negative resistance, what he called Ahimsa, the doctrine of non-resistance, which now has become the center of the modern Indian movement for the environment. It is applying the non-violence and non-resistance of the Gandhi movement to the world of nature. I might have put that word down for you because it's a very important term that is now entering into the English language. It's a Sanskrit term, which means actually non-aggression, non-violence, non-resistance to an aggressive force, and therefore resistance in a negative way, which was then taken over also in the United States by the late Dr. Martin Luther King, was taken over in Europe by certain people, and Gandhi has his followers. But besides the political element, which is not the subject of this course, Gandhi believed that the salvation of India was not to emulate Great Britain and the British technologies, but in fact to revive the cottage industries and the crafts of India. In this, Gandhi was partly, of course, trying to put economic pressure upon England, because England was buying cotton and cloth, and usually yarn, for practically nothing from India, feeding his factories in Liverpool and Birmingham and places like that, all of his textile factories, and then selling the cloth back to India and to the rest of the world at very high price. That is the key why these European countries are so rich. And if you're American students, you ever go to Europe and say, why is it in a little country like Belgium a cup of coffee costs $5? What is the Belgium with all the money? This little country has no oil, no steel, very little agriculture. Where did all the money come from? Of course, it came from this. It came from modern technology that is bringing out the wealth of the Congo for practically nothing to Belgium, then producing goods which then we sell at a very high price and keeping the money. So Gandhi really wanted to fight against that, and he wanted to take out the Indian market out of the hand of the British. That is, he said all those, at least at that time, India had a population of 300 million. It wasn't like 870 million now. He said these 300 million people should weave their own cloth. And the pictures you'd always seen of Gandhi sitting down and with the yarn and weaving cloth and making yarn had to do precisely with this. Now, this was not only, however, an expedient economic move on behalf of Gandhi. Gandhi had come to believe that the application of modern technology would destroy the human spirit and finally destroy the world of nature. And it's interesting that in this point, in this crucial point, Gandhi was influenced by that movement in England in the 19th century, especially the movement of William Morris, whose name I put on the board before, and John Ruskin. I'll put this on the board again. These are two names that you should know for your general education anyway. These men also had a lot to do with the history of art in Britain in the 19th century, with setting up important museums. They influenced England. Art, American art in the 20th century, in the 19th century, some of the famous American painters like Cole, who painted nature, were actually influenced by the movement of William Morris. So it's a very important movement. But William Morris, as I told you, was the person, some came from English nobility, who fought against the very ugly industrialization of England in the 19th century and thought that society should go back to means of production which are human and not inhuman, and use technologies which are simple, that is, tools rather than machines. There's a big difference between a tool and a machine. A tool is something of which we are the master. The forces, the movement, the speed is actually dictated by us. A machine is a very complicated tool in which we are no longer the masters. The speed, the movement, and the tempo is dictated by the machine to us. The whole subject of the difference between the two is very, very significant. There's a wonderful book in the English language by Ivan Illich, one of the greatest minds of this century on this subject. It's, I wanted to assign one of his books in this class, but there was nothing available, so coming across his name again. Ivan Illich is a very iconoclastic writer who's now in a terminal, terminal cancer and is about to die, but he refused to go to the doctor from the very beginning. He treated himself with alternative medicine because he wrote this book and called Medical Nemesis. And he said, I would never go against what I wrote. And 5 years ago, one of the greatest doctors in Germany, he said, you're going to die within 1 year, no matter what happens. Why don't you at least have an operation? There's a big growth on his head now. And he said, I'll make you a bet. If I'm still alive next year, you invite me to the best restaurant in Germany. Otherwise, I'll invite you. If I'm dead, from my state, they'll invite you. And next year, they had a nice dinner together. And I was totally astounded. He's still alive. And he's gone, been going on for 4 more years as an author of a series of books, all of which are very iconoclastic, which challenge many of our ideas. Medical Nemesis, The Schooling Society, which is against modern education, and all of the pseudo-ideals of modern education. Which is really jolting and has been read by many people. I hope Mrs. Clinton reads it while she's working on education now. And then a book which he wrote called Tools for Conviviality, which is a seminal work of the last 30 years, Tools for Conviviality, on the distinction between what is a tool and what is a machine, and how it's possible for human beings to humanize their means of production, and what it means when they don't. I just mentioned this for you to have in your notes in case some of you become interested in this. To come back to Gandhi, Gandhi made the clear distinction between a tool and the traditional industries of India, going back to what William Morris had written about in England, and the new machines, these vast giant machines, that textile machines, in which the person was like a cog in the wheel, like that film of Charlie Chaplin, which all of you have seen, which is one of the greatest masterpieces of criticism of modern technology. It becomes completely absorbed and devoured by movements and forces which are no longer human. And Gandhi, precisely because he was successful in India, because he was able to gain the independence of India, became a very important voice, the only major international voice in this century, of a major national leader who in fact was not pro a technology which would destroy the environment up until our own times. Of course, the great paradox is that the successor of Gandhi in India, that is Jawaharlal Nehru, just spoke about Gandhi. He did not heed his advice at all and tried to industrialize India as soon as possible. And he did not completely succeed. We see in our own generation now, in the last few years, finally the success in the industrialization of India. And God knows what's going to happen as a consequence of that. Just last July was the 60th anniversary of the birth of the Dalai Lama. And since age 60 is very important in the Far East and also in Tibet, we are all supposed to live 120 years if we don't eat too much fast food. And so the age 60 was traditionally considered to be the midpoint of life and the big celebrations. So a major celebration was held for the Dalai Lama in Delhi, of all places, with a temperature of about 200 degrees. And I attended because we're good friends. I didn't want to say no to him. And I was very saddened to see there the person who is now one of the leading disciples of Mahatma Gandhi in India, who worked for years and years in the Himalayas to try to preserve the natural scenery of the Himalayas, was imprisoned for 40 days by the Indian government because he was trying to prevent the big dam from being built there with all this money that the stock market is now pouring into India, so-called investment, and of course the Indian government. He said that over 50% of all the forests of the Himalayas have been destroyed in the last decade. And what that will mean in the future when the rains come and wash down all of the mountains into the rest of India, God knows. And we're going to be just at the edge of unbelievable catastrophes in the subcontinent of India. Because finally, the plan to fully industrialize the 50,000 villages in India are now going afoot with a great deal of capital, of course, invested by various countries, by these multinational corporations and all of these companies that bring money into India. And sort of the last gasp of the message of Gandhi is now being drowned in India. But it's not dead. During the last decade since his death, he was killed in 1948, almost 50 years ago. There have been continuously people in India who have followed him, but they have not been in the government. Every government in India has been 100% pro-modern technology. In fact, half of the chemical engineers in the world are Indian, the other half are everything else. If you go to MIT, by 95% of the part of chemical engineers are all Indians. Once Ananda Kumar Swami said, he said, what do you want to do? Create, just change India into a big fertilizer factory. Because they all study this, and they're a very large scientific force in India, which is now turning to modern technology. And all of the things that we talk about here in this country now, for example, recycling. The whole, all Indian villages are based on complete recycling. The dung of the cows in India, which are sacred in Hinduism, have a very important role to play in creating energy in India as an energy source. And it's unbelievable how everything is recycled. There's so little garbage that comes out of the villages of India. What will happen if they're going to produce one-tenth of the garbage that we produce every day? The world will be washed with garbage. We have 900 million people. Just using one paper bag a day, that makes 900 million paper bags. But it's just staggering to think of these two major civilizations, China and India, together having 2 billion people. If they begin to live like Europe and America, what will happen? But anyway, the voice of Gandhi is a very important voice to understand in the present-day context. And the reason that it's important is that after the death of Gandhi, when everybody put him on the pedestal without anybody following what he was saying, and the political forces within India, in Pakistan, in the West, even all the people in the West were pacifists who loved Gandhi's pacifism, they were all pro-technology. They did not understand the significance of Gandhi for the environment. Since then, no serious challenge to Western technology has come up in the West. Until you get this very intelligent terrorist who's the Unabomber. I believe that's a very significant thing, that a man who's demented, crazy, whatever he is, but very intelligent, he can be both intelligent and a madman. 20th century European history has presented plenty of examples of that. That he kills people because of exasperation, that his message will never be heard, because if you say the most intelligent things, at best they bring you on Oprah Winfrey's show for 5 minutes and then you're drowned out by 200 other voices on the end of it. You try to draw attention. At the same time, committing murder, expressing ideas which are very, very interesting and significant. I told my students the other term when this first came out how significant it was that the criticism against modern technology in America should come out from the mouth of a terrorist, of a murderer. Such a great tragedy, absolute tragedy. But nevertheless, what he has to say is quite interesting, quite significant. I don't know if any of you had a chance to read the Declaration of the Unabomber, which was he forced upon the New York Times and the Washington Post to publish. If you haven't read it, you should read it. It's a man, as I said, who is sick with many, many different psychological forces within himself. As I said, he's unfortunately not moral. He's an immoral person who murders and kills people. But what he has to say is quite something else. And why it is that these points cannot be debated seriously in the public forum is a very remarkable thing in our times. So the tradition you had that goes back to Thoreau in America and to William Morris and John Ruskin and to Mahatma Gandhi and to many lesser figures, in the last 20, 30 years has already become drowned in the world. The so-called third world has the least amount of interest at all in listening to this. But the argument that you give, that if you provide for leaders of those worlds, I don't like the term third world, but anyway, non-Western world and non-industrialized world, is that they say we are responsible to our people for what they want, even the good rulers. What do the people want? People, of course, want what they see. And most people do not think of the consequences. I mean, for example, the walking phone, the cell phone, which takes away the last few moments that one has of being by oneself in a car or something, like to make sure that one is never by oneself and never can interiorize oneself. But that spreads all over the world like wildfire because somebody sees it in Saudi Arabia and they want it. So these governments are not to be completely blamed. There's no government strong enough saying that now we're against all of these goodies, what appear to be goodies that are produced in the modern world. We're going to live our own traditional way of life. There are a few exceptions, like Sikkim, for example, the Himalayas, which was so small enough and high enough in the Himalayas to have closed its borders, actually, to the world, to the outside world, and to live by itself. There were other countries like that until the 1950s, two major countries, that is Tibet and Yemen. Last two completed traditional civilizations in the world, which were destroyed at the same time. One by the Chinese and one by the Egyptians. And the world turns its face while this destruction was going on and nobody cared. But now there's no place else left in the world. So the rest of the world also, the arguments are even much more difficult to give. Because in the rest of the world, let's say Pakistan, India, Egypt, Nigeria, wherever you go, it doesn't matter which continent you are on at all. The extreme negative effects of modern technology are only felt in air pollution and inconveniences like that. But people don't realize how fatal that is. Whereas they think that this process can go on without they're destroying themselves. They think they're going to get wealthy like the West. And it's very difficult to give this argument to them not to do what the West has done when the West has not given up doing what it has been doing. Of course, the most blatant case, most famous case of that is Brazil. All of the years when the rural valley was belching smoke into the heavens and northern New Jersey was not far behind, and you were destroying the environment and rivers and so forth all over the world, the vast forests of the earth were left untouched, more or less. The Japanese, during the Second World War, cut some of the trees in Sumatra and Java, but that was not very much. The decimation of the rainforest of the Pacific by the Japanese has been carried out in the last 20 years. And, of course, now the Amazon forest in Brazil has been destroyed with such rapidity. Why has it been destroyed with such rapidity? The whole of the program came from four blocks from here, from the IMF, just four blocks from here. The program that it proposed to Brazil in the 70s and 80s was to expand its agricultural areas for planting without any thought whatsoever what that would entail. And so the Brazilians, the Portuguese Brazilians, began to cut the forest with no interest whatsoever about what would happen to the climate of New York. Why should they care? And when you talk to them, they say, look, Germany did this in the 15th century. All of the fields in France and Germany that are planted, those beautiful fields, were forests 500 years ago. Connecticut was all a forest. And what is most interesting of all, a paradox of the world in which we live, since the 1500s, that is almost 500 years ago, 450 years ago, since, let's say, Columbus discovered America, which is exactly 500 years ago, 1492, the West wanted from the rest of the world raw materials. It wanted its wealth. But there's nothing that that world had without which the West could not live. Until we got to the 20th century and oil. And that the West gets by colonizing the Islamic world in the name of princes and rulers and kings and so forth, and nevertheless getting its oil for cheap price, and that's the end of it. But even that is not absolutely a matter of life and death. If tomorrow a real national government will come to power in those countries and say, we're not selling oil anymore, finished. The West has Mexico, there's a lot of oil in America that they put aside and nobody is extracting to put it for another day. And Western civilization will not collapse. Europe, a lot more would happen. Nothing would happen to America. But with the environment, for the first time, the non-Western world has something which is a matter of life and death to the West. And that is its forests, its water, even the air above it, because the air goes around the globe. The fact they get fresh air is not because the New York City air goes and makes the Atlantic fresh. It's because those parts of the world which have not polluted the air is still fresh. And it goes around, and it therefore provides fresh air for the rest of the world, but especially the forests, which clean the air throughout the globe. And so you have this very paradoxical situation in which the whole tragedy or crisis of man and the environment has come down to this present day situation in which you have one very powerful civilization with several forms in America, Europe, and to some extent in Russia, and only one country outside of this world which is highly industrialized, Japan, doing what they're doing, threatening the life of the globe, whereas the rest of the globe tries to emulate them. And many of the forces within this first world, which are still interested in justice and so forth, are helping it. And then to this is added, of course, all of the paradoxical problems which pit charity against justice. What do I mean by that? For example, the charity to help people medically, to try to save lives. And as soon as you save life, you're first of all being unjust to the rest of the life on earth. In the old days, a family would have 9 children, 2 or 3 would live, the other would die, the strongest would live, and the race would continue. Today, the populations are going up like that. And so but as soon as you help a child from malaria, you're posing a threat to the environment. And these are the questions I'm posing to you, are very complex and difficult questions, very painful questions, but we have to face it. And these are the major questions. And so you have two different sentiments, which even good human beings have in the West, that is charity versus justice. And they're working against each other because of modern science, because of modern medicine. And this brings up the whole question of life. And why do we want to save the environment? Is it to save the human life? How can we save human life if we do not save other forms of life? And then where does human life begin? The whole question of abortion, control of population, all of these things that are going on, for example, in China now, you know, the government passed a law that each family can only have 1 child. And the second child is brutally forced by the government to be put to death. That is, even if it's late, 8 months carrying a child, the child would be aborted. And if it's born, oftentimes it's killed. And there are all kinds of horrendous news coming out of China, which the Chinese government, of course, is denying, of actual children born allowed to die. And I hope that's not correct. But anyway, it's in all the papers. But look at it from the point of view of the Chinese government. What do you do with a population of 1.2 billion people? What do you do with the environment? And so we are faced actually with crucial questions which challenge the whole state of being human. In America, that overpopulation doesn't play a role that much because America still has vast amount of land thanks to the American Indians who kept it for 40,000 years to allow white Europeans in 5 centuries to do what we're doing. But you have the problem, for example, of the origin of life. When does life begin? And this debate that is going on between pro-abortion and anti-abortion, between Christians and secularists, between Catholics and liberal Protestants and Jews on this issue, is not only the question of human rights, it's also the question of meaning of life and the environment. The debates are very, very profound and very significant. And the reason I bring all of these up is to set the background for the course. That is, we, through our actions, through the way things have developed, have come to an impasse in which every choice that is made is painful and difficult. There are no easy choices. And there are very few governments strong enough to give the bitter pill for people to swallow. And that is why the most crucial of all questions for human beings on earth today, that is how to continue human life, more important than all other questions, even of social justice, economic justice, although they go together hand in hand oftentimes, the most important crucial question goes unanswered. It's the least interesting of all problems right now being debated by all candidates for the Republican Party and soon by all candidates for Republican and Democratic Party. It comes at about number 97. And of course, the president uses the word environment along with other issues in order to get votes of the people who are environmentally concerned. But look at the record of the last 3 years. And no worse, no better than the record of the 4 years before that and the 8 years before that and the 4 years before that. Because the differences between the Democratic and Republican Party is a complete epsilon, small difference when it comes to these issues. The much more important issues are economic issues, pocketbook so-called, which means also industry, business, use of capital, and someone wants to distribute a bit more, someone wants to put it in the hands of private initiative. But that's a political decision which is secondary to the question of the environment. So what we're going to try to do in this course, try to understand, how can such a thing have happened? How can human beings who have been living on the earth for 1 million years suddenly begin to live and think in such a way that within just a few centuries, they now threaten both their life and the life of most other creatures on the surface of the earth? To do that, we have to go back and analyze many, many different issues. The view towards nature, science of nature, the understanding of man, man's relation to nature, all of which means we must understand, therefore, what is the meaning of reality, what is the nature of reality, what is the meaning of human life, what is the values that we carry vis-a-vis the world of nature. Now, to do that, ideally, we would have to do it for the whole of the globe, because I told you the very first sentence I mentioned in this course, I said the only thing that all people on the earth today agree upon is the destruction of the natural world. Whether you are from the island of Sumatra or from Long Island, the only thing you have in common is this, that we're both helping to destroy the environment in the way that we live. But of course, one part of the world does it virulently with power, and one part of the world much less so. But because this is a course being taught in America and not in Sumatra, and because, in fact, what the West does is much more important than what the rest of the world does, because they're at the receiving end all the time. They're always at the receiving end of a technology which becomes outmoded. They're always eating from the breadcrumbs of the Western technological table. It's important to understand what's going on in the West, what has happened to Western civilization, and that's what we will be concentrating in this course, while paying some attention to other civilizations and other religions' point of view. But most of our attention will be paid to Western religious history, Western philosophical history, Western scientific history, the history of science and the understanding of nature. And we'll begin next time with that, going back to the Greeks and Christianity and building up from there and coming up.